For Krima Media's Polity, I'm Sane Dlamini. Joining me today is the former SAA Group Treasurer, Cynthia Stimpel, in conversation with Polity about her book titled Hijackers on Board. So Cynthia, can you please just first give us an insight into your upbringing? Because I believe that it is also linked to the values that you have as a whistleblower. Can you just briefly tell us about your family?
Yes, thank you very much. We grew up with a large family, but we also, my parents, my mom and dad, were really focused on ethics and doing the right thing. So when we did anything out of turn, we were either scolded or told not to do it straight away. And I can recall an example, which I also put in the book, is that my elder sister and I went to play just during the holidays, and we went to play at our neighbor's house. Our friend had lots of dolls, and we played with them all day. And it was time to come home, and we each grabbed a doll to take home. And the mother of our friend said, it's okay, you can bring it back tomorrow. So we promptly came home with these dolls, and my mom was livid. She just said, no, do not take anything that does not belong to you. And she marched us right back to our neighbors, told my friend's mom, I'm sorry about this, but my daughters are not allowed to take anything that doesn't belong to them. They can come back tomorrow and they can play with it, but they can't keep it overnight at home. So we had to promptly return these dolls. So just one of the examples. There were many things, and they also just taught us to be very self-sufficient. So we all had chores, we all had duties. We couldn't just sit and do nothing.
Cynthia, you also share how you had to change your career choice due to a disappointed advert because of your skin color. Can you briefly tell us about that?
I matriculated in 1974. And in those years, we all studied under different ministerial groups. So mine was under the colored affairs. My dad being Indian, my mom being colored, we were classified all as colored and lived in a colored area. I passed with a relatively good matric, and I wanted to do medicine and applied at Wits University, and promptly got a response saying I first got to get ministerial consent. When I applied for the ministerial consent, they said, no, they cannot give it to me. I have to go to Cape Town and study at the Belleville College. It was then called, before it was named, a university where colored persons could study. And obviously my dad, being the only breadwinner, he couldn't afford to send me there and pay for residence fees and the university. And he said, sorry, let's look for alternative measures. So yes, I didn't get to study at Wits. What I did get to do, though, was work at, he found in the newspapers, they were advertising for staff who work in the banks and one could study there. And that's what my dad recommended. And I followed his advice. And that's where I was. I spent the bulk of my career in banking and was able to study there part-time. And the funny part was, though, I ended up writing all my banker's exams at the very Wits University in the same hall that Wits students used to write. I always felt that I'm a Witsy still anyway.
It was interesting when I read it that even at DBSA, you resigned from your position as head of risk management because you were uncomfortable with some of the decisions there. Can you tell us why you were disappointed?
So I had a couple of years stint at DBSA. I chose DBSA more because of my own personal values and because of the values that was espoused at the DBSA. So in 2002, our country was involved with a world summit, and we had invited many countries here who displayed the climate and environment issues. We went there with my husband and my children, and we saw what DBSA and World Bank was involved in, that their mandate, especially DBSA, was uplifting the poor. And at that time, I was working for a corporate bank, earning quite good salary. But when I saw the values, I thought, this is the organization I should be working for, whereby I can add my skills and it will internalize to helping our country and alleviating poverty. And I applied to both World Bank and DBSA, and DBSA came back back first to me for interviews. I had about three, and then I was subsequently employed. But during my stint there, one of, as risk manager, is that we look at various projects that come to our desk, which DBSA would obviously fund, and what it would entail and who it will benefit. So most projects was either in the rural areas or funding a certain area to uplift or to build a building or infrastructure or the municipalities. This particular one was related to a transaction out in the Cape area, Franschhoek. It was called Frandefco, Franschhoek Development Corporation or Company. And at that time, they had aligned with the BEE organization. The B organization, when I did further research, found that it was made up of our very board members. And I then took this up with our CFO saying, how can our board members then be participating in the BEE component, because that is conflict of interest? She then said she will take it up with our credit committee, which it was. And at the time, the members who were part of this BEE component recused themselves at the meeting, and it was still decided. I think there were only two dissenting voices, and the rest agreed, and the deal went ahead. I was still very uncomfortable with that and decided I couldn't be part of the, and I wrote that in my resignation letter, that I cannot see that my values are now aligning with the organizations, and I therefore have to leave. And that's how I resigned.
In December 2006, you started at SAA as head financial risk manager. And you say in the book that your first day at SAA was not your typical day at a new job. What happened there?
Driving in the morning to work, the headline news says SAA retrenching staff. And I thought, oh my word, how did I not see this coming? And as I got into the office, and obviously you have to register and get a new card and all the paperwork. And then I met my boss because he had come down to ensure that everything was sorted. And then I went to his office and I said to him, but can you please explain the current news? The headline is saying that you're retrenching staff. And shall I leave right now and go back to my old job? And he just laughed at me and said, no, this is actually pertaining to another section where they need to retrench because they just had too many staff there. But he said Treasury was small. We were just starting out. And he said, no, they very much needed my skills. And so, yes, so that was the first part. The second part, I ended up working a full day because normally on first days, staff go home early. And I was late for a movie I was looking forward to seeing, yeah.
And you also, Cynthia, talk about the challenges of people coming and going at SAA and you having to act regularly as a group treasurer, being frustrating as well. But then you mentioned that the real problems, though, were presented due to the new law that was implemented at the time. We had the Home Affairs Minister, which was Malusi Gigaba, where parents were allowed now to produce unabridged certificates and written permission letters. You say there was a half-baked law, as you put it in the book. Can you tell us how that affected the company?
So unfortunately at SAA, there was the ruling of bringing firstly outside executives. And if one compared with, for instance, in Africa, Ethiopian Airlines, the staff that take the executive role will only be people who've been in the company and grown up in the company and had the skills, understood the culture, understood its business to the core. If one went internationally, Lufthansa operated on the same way. There's no one that would be a CEO or a CFO or any executive without being in the airline for a number of years. With SAA, unfortunately, our executive was always people from the outside. And I think that created, firstly, disruption where people didn't understand. You spend more time just trying to educate your executives instead of them coming in and just running with it. Regarding the law that changed under Minister Molisi Gigaba, he was the Minister of Department of Public Enterprises at the time. And he came up with this law that children couldn't travel without having unabridged birth certificates. when the law came out, it went into effect quite soon. There was an opportunity for, firstly, other countries and even South Africans to get their act into gear. The reason for that was because of child trafficking. The reason why I stated how baked, because if you're looking at child trafficking, it's happening across our borders. It's easy to smuggle children into boots or truckloads or hide them. Whereas in a plane, you have to see that child. That child goes through a screening process, through the visa process, through many processes to try and get that child across. So whereas across the borders, it was far worse if you were looking at child trafficking. So I just felt that they didn't think that through effectively if they were looking at child trafficking. But however, the impact and the knock-on effect it had on SAA was devastating because, let's say just me, for instance, I wanted to take my grandchildren on holiday with me. I couldn't because I wasn't the parent without getting the unabridged birth certificate, which takes quite long in our country. If it was a quick process, then one wouldn't see it as a problem. But the other effect was people coming overseas. And our best month for traffic is the winter months in the Northern Hemisphere. And we're having our summer months over September, October, December, Christmas period. And we have lots of people traveling then. There was this rule and people were stuck at the airport. We got so many requests that people were stranded because they didn't have the proper documentation. And so people were turned away and had to go back home, children crying, parents totally frustrated. With the result, people said, we're not flying SAA again. This is ridiculous. The impact was that I think a year later, the law was repealed, but the damage was done at a time where SAA really needed the funding.
And in the midst of all the challenges, Cynthia, you finally got your dream job at the SAA. You were appointed as the group treasurer. But it became a nightmare for you, clearly, from what I've read in the book. You discuss in the book the damage that was caused by a former SAA chairperson, Dudumieni, on the Airbus deal. Can you briefly share with our viewers?
The Airbus deal started already some years back, even prior to my time being at SAA, where it was discussed, obviously, you look in the future, what your current aircraft requirements are and what you're going to need in the future. And these were already discussed, agreed on, and approved by board. And then there was time and SAA had to pay these deposits, which are called pre-delivery deposits, on an aircraft, which if I have to translate it, how you and I would buy a car, we have to put a deposit down before we can take that vehicle and then we pay it off on a monthly basis. So what would transpire is with aircraft is that SAA would be paying these various deposits till they make up the substantial amount. Once it's ready for the delivery, the discussions then go, how do we do the final settlement? Do we work with the lessor or do you pay the full amount? So this had already transpired. Come the time now for SAA to take delivery of the aircraft, SAA was going through a financial crisis, cash crunch, and couldn't then pay the full amount that they wanted to. And in discussions with Airbus, decided to reduce the amount. So instead of 20 aircraft, they reduced it to 10 aircraft. The 10 aircraft was going to be this type of Airbus deal. And there was sufficient funding for the pre-delivery payments. And the agreement was made together because it's never one person deciding it. It's a group, an entire team, which is made up of the fleet committee, which is various levels within the organization. It has to go through board and it also has to be approved by the ministry. At the time, it had gone through the Minister of Public Enterprises and then SAA had changed its ministry to the National Treasury and was also approved by National Treasury at the time. Come towards, this was 2014, into 2015, suddenly Ms. Mieni, who was the chairperson, went to challenge the amount of aircraft and said no, that SAA is not going to be taking the full 10. They're only taking two with the lessor for the Airbus deal, and the rest was going to be some middleman, was the initial idea. It was challenged between the board members. I only got to know this information after I got to know about the Airbus deal first, but the challenge with the board members, I only got to know about much later. At the time, I didn't even know they were challenging it. They had challenged it. According to the Public Finance Management Act, which is the PFMA, you have to complete a Section 54 submission. And this normally was done by this fleet committee and then gone to the approvals. That's how the original was done. But a new one was done and was approved by an acting CEO and the new acting CFO together with Smyeni. And it went through to the National Treasury Minister Nene at the time. And obviously, he looked at that. In that document, they stated that there would be no currency risk. And that's how I got to know about it. National Treasury asked me, sent me the documents and saying, how did I allow this to get through when there's a currency risk? And I read it and I said, well, I didn't have privy to the information, but there is definitely currency risk. Reason being, when you're purchasing an aircraft, you're purchasing it in dollars. As South Africa, we have to pay in rand. Anything that's already in the market related in currency, you will have that currency impact. For instance, if I may translate it for our viewers, is that our petrol price. That's why it's so volatile, because petrol is priced, the Brent crude price is priced in dollars, but yet we pay in rand. And if the price is like today, almost $82 per barrel, we ain't to feel the impact when we pay it in rand. So similarly, when we're paying the aircraft in dollars, we, as SAA at the time, would be paying the repercussions in rand if they should translate in the market volatility. And so there's definitely currency risk. Minister Nene, though, obviously rejected this new proposal. And within a week of that, he rejected it on the 3rd of December, 2015. Within a week of that, he was then also fired as minister, obviously for various other transactions, which he also rejected, which was the nuclear transaction, which we all know about. The new minister who came in then said SAA to go and keep the original documentation and follow it, which was what happened.
Were you surprised by Minister Nene's firing?
I was when we got the news, because I didn't expect it, because he was a relatively solid minister, made very solid and thought through decisions. So yes, and it had a major impact on our stock exchange. It had an impact on our rand. The rand price had fallen. The stock exchange lost over 500 billion overnight, and on the subsequent days lost some more. That business had to step in and had to say, please bring in a solid minister now. We can't be having someone who's unknown to the market, to the international sphere. And so they brought back Minister Gordhan at the time, and that stabilized the markets.
The board got involved operationally, and you say that was uncomfortable. What kind of interference are you referring to in the book, if you can share briefly?
So with that, when I took over as group treasurer, then the first part where they interfered, and I can speak from my side, I know they interfered in other departments like our procurement department and the SA technical, but from a funding perspective and from a treasury perspective, we've been doing funding since 2007. And in those years, treasury department did the funding. We always took it to board for review. We never did anything without board approval, and then we would implement what board had approval. We make the recommendations, obviously. We go out on a request for proposal, get the funding from the banks. The banks are credit rated, and that's why we deal with banks. We also had a financial risk management policy, which states specifically that you need to work with certain suppliers, and they need to be credit rated, and they need to have certain criteria. That was how we operated. So since 2007 up to 2016, ISA has been borrowing funds on an annual basis on the back of a government guarantee from National Treasury. This particular time is that the first was when ISA board wanted to be involved in the request for proposal process. they wanted to give supplier names. They wanted to look at the RFP up front before we could even send it out to the clients. The next thing with giving the clients, we were very against it, at least I was. And when I spoke to my then boss, who had subsequently resigned within the next couple of weeks, had also said he was uncomfortable, but felt that no harm if we added those clients, because he said they wouldn't meet the criteria anyway because they weren't credit rated or anything. And so we thought, okay, let's add them anyway and we'll send it, which we did. It was those very clients that responded. For instance, some didn't make the criteria, so we couldn't even analyze them. But one particular client came out, and this client was Seacrest, who said they can lend SAA full $15 billion at a good rate of, at the time, was 5.8% over a 10-year period, and give SAA a 5-year grace period. And that was too good to be true. And when that happens, the red flags for me were really just flying, thinking, oh my word, this can't be. We need to do further research. We requested our legal department to do full due diligence on the client. The client, Seacrest, were able to supply information, but the partner who they were going to get the funding from was Grisac, refused to give any information. We did our own research and found that Grisac was a small company based in the Free State on a farm run by two directors, one a Russian director, Sergei Pokosiev, and the other was Mr. Van der Merwe. And we couldn't get that information. So obviously, they didn't pass the due diligence, so we couldn't recommend it. So when we wrote up our document, we said we cannot recommend this because they didn't pass it. We went again with the banks. The banks in total could only supply us with roughly $4.5 billion rather than the full $15 billion. But then our board, when they gave the board resolution, they come up with something totally different. They tell us to go ahead with a client called Free State Development Corporation, who was never part of the request for proposal process. We're never anywhere near. We did no analysis. We didn't know anything about the client. And then I get called in to ratify this decision. And that's when I pushed back. I said, I will not ratify it. I don't know this client. It didn't come through our internal processes. I asked for more information. I said, please give me the board resolution. Then only I can make a decision. In the board resolution, it states that they made this decision via a letter that was circulated at board. Now, if you know board are supposed to apply their minds, there should be enough information in the board pack for the board directors to review it, to ask questions, to challenge, to interrogate. And they did none of that. Wow. So already you can see that there was totally wrong. So that was just one of the examples where they totally interfered.
How do you feel now as a whistleblower? Because in the end, you were suspended at SAA.
Yes, so I got suspended, and for more than almost a year, I spent in courts. I went for my disciplinary hearing. SAA was not prepared, actually. My lawyer and I were prepared. They weren't prepared for it. We then took it to the Labor Court, and the Labor Court said we got to take it through the CCMA, which we did. And every time we appeared at the CCMA, SAA sent their lawyers, but no representative from SAA. So we obviously couldn't sit down and complete the arbitration. And in the end, my lawyer recommended just, you know, get your life back. This could run for another 3-4 years. And rather you about to retire, you're 59 years. Let's see if we can get early retirement, just close it and you can continue with your life. And I spoke to my family and that's what we did. But prior to that, we actually interdicted, where I feel was the good thing we were able to do, because we actually stopped the transaction from happening. And that saved SAA roughly, the money they would have spent was 250 odd million. It saved them. And in the end, we look at state capture, it saved our country that amount of 256 million. So that part was the good part. The part that I didn't expect, and I felt quite naive, thinking that I'm doing the right thing. I'm being loyal to my company. I'm saying this is wrong. We shouldn't be doing it. It's against all our policies, procedures, and good governance and our ethics. And yet I'm the one who lost my job and was victimized by the organization. Mm. But how do I feel now? I must say I'm happy that I did whistleblow because we saved that money. Also, I feel it's just the right thing. We all need to start standing up and speaking out, because if we look at the extent of where our country is right now, I'm sure there's many people who know certain things have happened that was not right, and they kept quiet for fear of their jobs, which I totally agree with. We all need our jobs, but when we start standing together, we become stronger, you know. And I do also fully understand that we could lose our lives. Some have lost their lives. In a recent case with Babita Diokaran on the COVID-19 PPE procurement, had lost her life. I'm very, very sorry that happened to her and the repercussions on her daughter. We as South Africans need to stand up. And that's what I'd like to say, that we all really need to stand up. And if we stand together, we all will be stronger and we can save this country.
That was Cynthia Stimpel in conversation with Polity about her book titled Hijackers on Board.